Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the operation of MPLS traffic engineering with an OSPF underlay. I strive to simplify telecom and networking concepts, turning intricate topics into straightforward, digestible insights. It's the kind of approach I wish I had when I was starting out. If this style resonates with you, make sure to hit like, subscribe, and enable notifications to stay up to date with my new content. Now, here is the topology that we created in our last video, where we configured MPLS-TE, OSPF-TE, RSVP-TE, and our tunnel interface on our ingress label switching router. Here you can see our unidirectional tunnel created through our MPLS infrastructure. Here's a short reminder of what we configured. We enabled MPLS-TE on all of our PE and P routers, both globally and on their relevant interfaces. We enabled OSPF-TE extensions on all of our PE and PE routers. We configured RSVP-TE on all interfaces on our P and PE routers. And we configured a maximum bandwidth of 500 megabits per second to be reservable by RSVP. And finally, we configured our MPLS-TE tunnel on our ingress LSP router, which is PE1 here, with a maximum bandwidth of 1 megabit per second on the tunnel itself. Now, the result is the creation of an MPLS-TE tunnel through the topology. Now, at this point, the tunnel exists, but it doesn't do anything. We must route traffic through it in order to use it, just like any other interface on a network device. Now let's take a look at some commands that will give us a closer look at some of the parameters of our MPLS-TE topology. First, let's take a look at PE1's OSPF-TE links. We issue the show IP OSPF MPLS traffic ENG link command to show information about all the links on this router that are participating in OSPF-TE. There are two links that appear in the output, but on this screen, we start off looking at information about the first link. There's quite a bit of information here, so let's explain some of it. We see the OSPF-TE router ID that we specified, which is the IP address of our loopback 0 interface and our OSPF area process of 1. The next line states that area 0 has two MPLS-TE links, this one and this one. It also says that the area instance is 5. Now, the area instance is a unique identifier that's assigned by OSPF for MPLS-TE to track the instances of the traffic engineering database for a specific OSPF area. It is used internally by OSPF to differentiate and manage multiple instances of the MPLS-TE database for the same OSPF area. In this case, the area instance is 5, which means that OSPF has identified this specific instance of the MPLS-TE database in area 0 as the 5th iteration. The area instance can change when there are modifications to the OSPF-TE database, such as a new TE link being added, removed, or updated. This helps OSPF differentiate between older and newer versions of the database, ensuring consistency and correctness when distributing TE information. Next, we see the phrase links in hash bucket 27. Now, this refers to an internal hashing mechanism used by OSPF to organize and retrieve MPLS-TE link information. A hash bucket is essentially a virtual container or an index in a hash table where the specific link information is stored. The links are hashed based on their attributes, including link ID and interface address. The bucket number in this case is 27, and this is the result of the hashing function and indicates where the link data is stored in the hash table. Hash buckets allow OSPF to quickly locate and retrieve information about a specific TE link when needed. This is especially useful in large-scale networks with many TE links as it optimizes memory usage and speeds up database lookups. Next, we can see that the information contained here is associated with fragment 2 and link instance 5. Now, TE information can be extensive, and OSPF has a limit on the size of an LSA. When the amount of information to be advertised about MPLS-TE links exceeds this size, the information is divided into multiple pieces or fragments. And this fragment number here simply indicates which fragment of this particular LSA contains the information. The instance is the same as what we saw earlier in the area instance. Next, we get into the information about this particular TE link. We see here that it's connected to a broadcast network segment, as expected, with a link ID of 10.10.50.2, which is the IP address of the neighboring P3 router. And we have an interface IP address of 10.10.50.1. And then we have some information about the link. This is where the various TE parameters, known as constraints, are seen. We have the TE metric and the IGP metric, which are metrics associated directly with OSPF. Then we have the maximum bandwidth, which is in bytes per second, and represents the physical capacity of the link. This value is based on the interface's hardware capacity, or the bandwidth configured on the interface itself. Next, we have the reservable bandwidth. Now, this is the value that we have configured in the interface using RSVP-TE. And we've set that value to 500 megabits per second, which in bytes per second is 62,500,000, as we see here. Next, we see some additional TE parameters, including priority levels and affinity. I won't go into these here, but suffice it to say for now that these are TE-specific constraints that can be modified to adjust the routing behavior of OSPF-TE. Now, let's take a look at the parameters of the second link. Here we see OSPF-TE information about this link. We see that this information is found in a different hash bucket within the TE database with a value of 28, and it's contained within fragment 3 this time of the LSA. The link instance, however, is the same. We can see the link ID and the interface address as expected, and we can see the same values for the metrics, the maximum bandwidth, and the reserved bandwidths that have been configured. The priority levels and affinity are also the same as the other link we examined. Now, priorities and affinities are an important part of traffic engineering, and we'll talk about those in detail in an upcoming video, so stay tuned. For now, let's continue looking at our OSPF-TE parameters. Now, for those of you that have studied OSPF in detail, you will be aware that OSPF uses what are known as link state advertisements, or LSAs, to advertise networks. There are different types of LSAs for different types of OSPF topologies and areas. OSPF-TE introduces a new type of LSA called Type 10, which is also known as an opaque LSA. This LSA contains TE information. Using this command, we can display part of the OSPF database, and we can see all of the opaque LSAs that have been received by the PE1 router. We have the LSA with an advertising router of 3.3.3.3, which is P3, and another with an advertising router of 1.1.1.1, which is P1. However, there are more LSAs further down in this output. Let's take a look at the rest of the configuration components of the MPLS-TE topology. With this command, we can take a look at the TE topology from the point of view of the local node, which has an MPLS-TE ID of 1.0.0.1. This command gives us a list of links that the PE1 router has and the characteristics of each of these links. For this link, we can see the various parameters used by IGP, which is indeed OSPF, including the IGP router ID, the MPLS-TE router ID, the routing protocol, and the area ID. We can also see the constraints, including the TE metric, IGP metric, attribute flags, as well as the SRLGs. We can also see the information about the physical bandwidth and the maximum reservable bandwidth. And finally, we can also see 8 bandwidth priority levels that exist by default for MPLS-TE. And here we can see a similar output for the next link, which is that one that connects to P1, with much the same contents in the output. Finally, we can take a look at the RSVP status on the router's interface using this command. You can see from the output that RSVP has been enabled on both of these interfaces. Now, using the show MPLS traffic engineering tunnels command, you can take a look at the details of the tunnel we created. along with other important information, we can see the destination, which is the PE2 router, the status of the tunnel, as well as the configuration parameters, including the bandwidth we configured. The rest of the parameters remain at their default values. We can also see the MPLS information about this tunnel, including the label which will be used, which is 20, the source and destination IP addresses, as well as the explicit route that has been determined. We have RSVP path information, which includes a list of IP addresses, which indicates the addresses of every interface that is traversed, including the ingress and egress addresses. Then we have the RSVP reserve information, which includes specifications of the tunnel itself, and finally a history of the tunnel states. Now I know that we went through this quite quickly and there is a lot of information here, but not to worry because we will be digging deeper into these concepts to find out more about them in future videos. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment below. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.